Masechet Pesachim, Daf Het. We have two main topics today. One is, why do we use the lamp light for Bedikat Chametz? And the second will be, where is one required to do Bedikah, where one brings Chametz? That discussion will lead into a tangent about a very important principle that Shidduchei Mitzvah and Enan Nizokin. Someone who's on the way to do a mitzvah cannot be harmed. Okay, you see that quoted a lot, and the Talmud today will be very instructive in explaining where and when is appropriate to apply that principle. Okay, so we begin with why a lamp? We ended last time with giving the symbolic meaning of it. We quoted Ner Hashem Nishmat Adam, that this is in a way a time of introspection, that our soul is like a candle into ourselves, Hashem checking our deeds. And so when we're doing Bedikat Chametz with the lamp, we are thinking about that introspection also, and thinking about to be humble and get rid of our ego, which is represented by Chametz. But now we're going to get to the practical details as well of why not check with sunlight? Isn't that also bright, or with a torch? So we start with the Baraita. Tanu Rabbanan en bodkin lo le'ol ha'or ha'chama ve'lo le'or ha'lebana. You may not use sunlight or moonlight. Today we have a beautiful new moon. Still, you cannot use that for bedikat chametz. Ve'lo le'or ha'avuka, and not a torch. Ela le'or ha'ner, just a simple lamp, single flame. The reason is because it's effective, it's appropriate for checking well. Even though there's no explicit verse regarding this matter, there is a hint to it. And now it'll give the list of verses we said before. We know that you have to yimaseh, cannot be found, chametz cannot be found. And that word, yimaseh ve'omer ve'chapes bagadol hechel, and regarding Yosef, when he's checking their sacks, it says ve'yimaseh, in the same pasuk it says ve'chapes, so we connect finding to searching, and the word searching, ve'chapes, is found in another pasuk, ve'atahi ha'chapes et Yerushalayim banerot, ve'omer ner Hashem nishmat adam chofes kol hadre baten. And so too, Hashem will search for Jerusalem for evildoers with a candle. And also God will search our own deeds and thoughts with the candle of our soul. Okay, so therefore that's the derivation that we know. It's more of an agadah, but now we're going to focus on the halacha of it. Hai or hachama hechidame, what kind of case would it be appropriate to use sunlight to check? In ema behased, maybe outdoors, a courtyard. Amarava hased enasericha bedika mipneh shearvin nesuin sham. Rava taught that a courtyard does not require bedika, because even if you go and have a picnic outside and some bread falls on the floor, there's no problem because the ravens will come and eat it. So you can be sure that there is no chametz left in the courtyard, so you don't need bedika there at all. Ela be'achsadra. Achsadra is a portico, which means it has a roof, but the sides are all open. And so maybe you'll eat out there. And since it's somewhat covered, and the ravens won't eat the chametz there. Rava taught about that an outdoor portico, you can actually use sunlight. So you are permitted in some cases to use sunlight. Obviously this wouldn't be during the night, during bedikat chametz, but perhaps beforehand. There are other areas that you'll check beforehand. And then at night you focus on the inside, indoors at home. So therefore, one of these cases doesn't need bidika. The other one, you can actually use sunlight. So this baraita that says you cannot use sunlight, what case is it prohibiting? Rather, it's talking about indoors, a room that has a skylight, and the sun comes in and makes the room bright. And so I might have thought that that would be okay. And that's what the baraita is telling me, that you cannot do that. Udehecha, hold on, where are you talking about? If it's exactly right under the skylight where it has direct sunlight, that would be the same as the portico, which has sunlight coming in directly and would be permitted. Rather, it's talking about the side of the room that only gets indirect light from the sun. That's what it's talking about when it says there is some light that goes there, but you cannot use that for sunlight. This is actually very interesting. We already now are learning important exceptions to the rule that a place where sunlight actually comes directly, you would be permitted to use that light. And you know, nowadays we have lots of windows in our homes most of the time. In those days, they had much fewer windows. First of all, glass would be very expensive. Their windows were basically just open air that they would close up with a piece of wood. And so it would get very cold. And so most people only had a small window somewhere, which means even during the day, it was pretty dark in their homes. So sunlight would not work for most areas of the home. But in certain areas where there's direct sunlight, then you could actually use sun. All right, good. So now that we solved the sun, the moon would be, we would apply the same thing. How about abuka? Babuka lo? Why can't you use a torch? Ba'amaraba, ma'dichti ve'noga ka'or tihye karnai miyado lo besham habyon ozo. This is a pasuk in Habakkuk. It's describing the brightness of God's glory, which says that it is like the light. So ka'or, as she explains, like the light of creation, it will be in the end of days also, will parallel. Kanai miyador lo, there's light all around him, all around God. And the chabion means hidden. Shem chabion ozo, and that is only, the light that you can see is only part of it. Really God's actual strength is hidden. The point is that there's the light that we can see, the light saved for tzaddikim in the future world, and that is only a small part of God's full light. That's the pasuk. Lema tzaddikim domin b'fnei shechina. So how can we compare the light that the tzaddikim can enjoy with the actual light of shechina? Kaner b'fnei avuka. The ratio is like a lamp, one lamp, and before a torch. So tzaddikim is just a little bit of light is like a lamp. What's the point of quoting this? Nice midrash, but the point is that if you're going to search for chametz, why not use a more powerful light? Why not use something that's a torch so that you can see better and find more chametz? Furthermore, said Havdalah, so to use a torch, and that is halakha, we like to use at least 2 wicks to have a nice big fire. We're going to say and appreciate the fire. We should use a torch. So you see that in these two teachings, a torch is better than a single wick lamp. So why not use that for bedikat hametz as well? We're going to see 4 answers. Amar Rav Nachman bar Yitzchak, ze yachol lachniso lachorin velistakin. Ze eno yachol lachniso lachorin velistakin. The first, the lamp, it's small. I can bring it into small crevices and small holes. A torch is much bigger. I won't be able to fit it into those small nooks and crannies. Second answer, Rav Zevida Amar, ze oro lefanav, ze oro leacharav. The lamp light goes forward, the torch goes back. I think what this means is when you have a torch, your eyes end up being dilated, and so you cannot actually see that much around the torch. It kind of sucks in all the view. Whereas a small lamp will give you just enough light so that you can see a pinpoint where you want to see and be able to see actually better in front of you. It says, one of them, the torch causes fear. Are you carrying a torch around? You're going to be afraid the house is going to burn down, so you're not going to want to bring it to all the rooms and everywhere. Whereas the single flame, you will not be afraid, and then you'll actually do a better job looking all around. The single flame lamp has a nice, a smooth light, whereas the flame dances around, fluctuates, and actually makes it more difficult to see. You think you see something, but maybe it's just the light flickering. And for all those reasons, better to have a nice small light that is safe and that you can direct and pinpoint and find chametz better. Okay, good. So those are all the reasons. So now we finished with the reason why we use a lamp light. And now we're gonna go to the places of where we need to check. Komakom she'en machnisin, the Mishnah says that any place that you don't bring chametz normally, you don't have to do bidikat chametz. You don't have to check your boiler room. You don't bring chametz down there. So komakom la'atuyemai. So since the Mishnah, I'll show you the Mishnah here. right? It says, doesn't say to say makom shen machnisin, it's the word kol makom. We're treating the Mishnah almost like it's a level of pesukim that we're going to make a diyuk. Why add the extra word all places? What is it coming to include? So latuyeh had the tanur banam. It's coming to include the list of items in the following baraita chore bayit alyonim v'tachtonim. If you have a wall is packed with holes all around. So the holes that are mid-level, so people would store things in those holes. But one that's very high or very low are hard to get to. It's like, you know, when you have a bunch of lockers, everybody wants the middle locker, right? Nobody wants the top locker, the bottom locker, very hard to use. And therefore, no one stores things on the holes all the way on the bottom of a wall. So you don't even have to check them. You're not going to put your chametz there. Also, the roof of a shed, which are sloped. Most of their homes had flat roofs, which they would use. They would go up there. They would put fruit out there. They'd hang out. But a shed has a slanted roof, so you're not going to put anything on a shed. Or if you have a closet, like an armoire, has a slanted roof. No one puts anything up there. Also, a cow shed or a chicken coop. There might be chametz in there, but surely the cows and the chickens will eat any chametz that's in there. So you don't have to check them. Umatben, the place where you store hay, straw. You don't store chametz. Vosrot yain, vosrot shemen, storehouses of wine and oil. Also, you don't store chametz in there. It's only for wine and oil, so you don't need to check them. And serichin bedika. Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel omer, mita hacholeket betoch habayit. If I have a bed in the middle of a room that is acts as a divider, does dual duty as the setup of the room. So the bed is in the middle and it has space underneath. So since it's in the middle of the room and it's accessible, the space underneath is useful. And I might store some bread under there, save for later. Maybe I forgot it there, but I have to do bidika in such a case. Good. So this baraita gives a list of things that you do not need bidika, and then the ashpag, one item that does require bidika. Fine, that's clear enough. But we have a seemingly contradictory baraita. What mean who? Hol sheben adam lachavero ze bodek ad mekom sheyado magat. Let's say I share a wall with my neighbor and has holes in it, and some of the holes go all the way through from my house to the neighbor's house. So I have to check inside that hole up to where my arm reaches. And the other person on the other side, assuming he's Jewish, will check his side of the wall, I guess it's a very thick wall, until his hand can reach. Any space left over in between, it does to be tall, you can't reach there anyway. The truth is, how would you ever put something in there if you can't reach? So you don't have to worry that there, whatever chametz happened to fall into it. So here you see a case of a wall where you do have to check. So this seems to contradict the first Mishnah, the first Baraita that said you don't have to check certain areas of a wall, the top and the bottom. Okay, the answer is pretty obvious, but well, let's go step by step. Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel omer, mita haholeket betocha bayit ve'asim ve'abanim sedurim tachteha u'mafseket ena sericha bedika. So Rashbag adds, if you have a bed that divides, also acts as a room divider, and underneath the bed I put wood and rocks, and there's u'mafseket, and there's a little bit of space still left over between the rocks I put there and the bed, I don't have to do bedikat chametz in that case. Good. So now we have these two beraitot that are talking about slightly different cases. Let's try to reconcile them. Kasha mita mita, kasha horin achorin. Two questions. The first Mishnah was lenient regarding holes. The second Mishnah, second beraita said, I have to check the holes, put my hand in as far as it can go. Then also a question on the under the bed. The first one, Rashbag says, I have to check under the bed. The second one, he said, I don't have to check under the bed. So which is it? Answer, horin ahorin lakashya, ha be'ila'e ubetata'e v'ha be'misa'e. Okay, when we said you do have to check, right, as far as your hand can go, that was talking about the ones that are mid-range. And so that's what I have to check. And the first baraita that says high and low, that's when I said, you don't have to check because they're high and low and they're not useful. Okay, that's actually quite explicit. The mita mita lakasha, we don't have to question that either. The beds ad midalaya ad mitatai. So the one that said you do have to check is raised off the ground. There's a lot of space there, and so that would be conducive to storing maybe a bottle of beer or something. And the other one where there's already I'm already storing some wood and rocks there. There's only a little bit of space, so it's not conducive to put it using for storage, and therefore I do not have to check there. Okay, wonderful. Now the Braita also mentioned osrot yayin en sarich bedika, and is that true that we don't have to check a storehouse of wine? Matanya osrot yayin sarich bedika, osrot shemen en sarich bedika. Another Braita they made a distinction that said wine storage does need bedika, only oil storage room does not need bedika. The answer is it depends on whether I access it regularly during the meal or not. So when we said that you don't have to check osodot yain, that was the previous baraita, that's talking about one that's put away for long-term storage and I don't access it. This baraita here is talking about one that in the middle of the meal, I might say, hey, you know what, I'd like some more wine, and I'll carry my sandwich down to the wine cellar. I'll put it down to get more wine, and maybe I'll forget a piece of bread there. So therefore, since I use it, I access it during the meal, that's why I have to check on it. So we ask, if that's the case, then why not oil also? Oil is something that we use during a meal. So why don't I have to check the oil storage closet? Shemen yesh keba l'achila, yayin en keba l'shtiya. The reason is because oil, we know how much oil the guests are going to consume during a meal. There's a standard amount. So beforehand, the chef will go get the oil, and that's, you know, you covered for the meal. Whatever you're using it for, dressing, cooking. Whereas wine, you never know how much people are going to want to drink. And so in the middle of the thing, they might say, oh, let's get some more wine. And so therefore we do access the wine during the meal. We do not access oil during the meal. Okay, this is a place where we store oil. It reminds me of another story. You know, the Aleppo Codex was stored in the Great Synagogue in Aleppo for 600 years. For some of that time, it actually was stored in the room where they kept the oil, the burning oil. And then one time there was a fire that almost damaged the Aleppo Codex. And so then they realized that that is not a good place to store it. And they moved it to the Cave of Eliyahu room where it was then more recently. Just a piece of trivia there. Okay, good. So Taner Bichia. Asu oserot shechar bebavel ki oserot yayin beres Yisrael bemistapek. So he adds that in Bavel, in Israel, they used to drink wine a lot. Wine was almost the normal drink. It was like drinking juice. They would put some wine in their water to kill the germs. So in Bavel, they normally drank shechad, a beer, during a meal. And so therefore, for them, the beer storage closet was also needed bidikat chametz because they normally went and accessed the beer during meals. Now, I know what you're thinking. Beer itself is chametz. So what do you mean, check the beer storage? Don't you have to get rid of all of the beer? It seems that they did not drink barley beer, but rather date beer. And so the beer itself was kasher lePesach, only worried about something else. I'm not sure what date beer is. And if anybody's ever drank anything like that, let me know. Okay. Amar Rav Chisda, be'edagim en sarich bedika. Rav Chisda says, the place where you store the fish, I assume it's like salted fish, so it stays good. And you store it, so you do not need to. You don't bring food in there. You just access it to take food out. Batanya tzirich in bedika. We have another braita though. We have a braita against Rav Chisda that says you do need to check the fish storeroom. It's not a problem. But one's talking about large fish. The large fish you do not have to check because you go in and you say, you know, you take a big piece of fish, so that'll be the main meal, and you know how many you're going to eat. Whereas the small fish, in the middle of the meal, someone might say, hey, get some more of those sardines. They're more like a side dish, an appetizer. And you never know how many people are going to want. And since you access it during the meal, the person who goes to get it might bring chametz into the storeroom. Good. Amar Rabba Rav Huna be milche u be kire sarich bedika. The place where you store the salt and where you store the wax, you do require bidika, because often during the meal, you'll go and get more salt or get some more wax for candles. So you'd have to do bidika there. Amara papa, be sibe, ube tamre, sarich bidika, the place where you store wood or dates also requires, right? I mean, all year long, anytime during the week, you might need more wood for the fire. And so might be during the meal. So you might bring chametz in those places. Okay, so now we get to this very interesting topic. So let's say there's the hole in the wall, and who knows, maybe you one time stored some chametz in there and forgot about it. This Tosefta says you are not required to stick your hand inside that crevice to check for chametz because of danger. Now, what danger are we talking about? We're going to see two answers. Here's number one. My sakana. Ine ma bipne sakanat akrab. Ki mishtamesh. Echi ishtamesh. So perhaps you're going to say it's because of a scorpion. Like this is some interesting trivia about a quarter of species that are known to us are poisonous. So you might be afraid and there'd be a scorpion in there. So as important as bidikat chametz is, you don't have to risk your life for it. So, but the question on that is, wait a second, how did you get the chametz in there in the first place? I mean, if it's dangerous to stick your hand in, then why would you stick your hand in to put your sandwich in there to hide it? Maybe they're sticking their cake in it to hide it from the kids, right? So if it was so dangerous and you're worried about scorpions, you wouldn't use it in the first place. And therefore, you wouldn't need to teach that you don't need to, because you don't bring chametz there. So la sericha dinafal. Oh, it must be a case where the chametz fell there by mistake. It was walking by and it fell. I didn't put it in there intentionally. All right. Inafal lama li bedika. Batenan chamesh inafla lama polet arehu ke mevo'ar. But then it wouldn't require because we have a mishnah. It's coming up soon. Chametz that fell. This fell must be that actually the wall fell upon it. So if I have chametz and the wall falls down and it's under rubble, then that's as if it's been removed. I don't have to do buruch b'yon chametz. Any chametz that's not accessible to me, it's as if it's gone. And so if you're talking about a case where the wall fell down, then I don't have to do bidika either. Hatam she'en hakelev yachol lechapes acharav, hacha kishakelev yachol lechapes acharav. So make a distinction. That mishnah that says the wall fell down, you don't have to do bidika. That's talking about where it fell down totally. And even a dog wouldn't be able to recover the chametz. Our case is talking about a case where there was a hole in the wall and I put some chametz, there was some chametz there and it partially fell. And so now that it partially fell, the scorpions are more likely to be there. And it is somewhat accessible. So I might have had to do bidika. Because I'm afraid of scorpions, that's why I don't have to. Okay, so now we understand, but whatever, there's some kind of case, right, where somehow the chametz got there, but now it's a dangerous hole, and I might have thought I have to take it out, but if you're afraid of scorpions, then don't put your hand in and do not take it out. Okay, good. And now we ask our question. Rabbi Elazar has this statement that if you're on your way, if you're doing a mitzvah, then you will not be harmed. So therefore, I'm doing mitzvah, but the bidikat chametz is a mitzvah. So therefore, can I be guaranteed that I will not come to harm? I don't have to worry about it. Even the scorpion's there. I could put my hand right in, right? Answer is no. Amar Rav Asher, shema tovad lo machat. Batel ayune batra. Rav Asher says, yes, it's true. While you're doing a mitzvah, then yes, but maybe your intention will be for two things. I'm doing a mitzvah to find the chametz. But you know what? One time happened to be, I also dropped a needle in there. And while I'm at it, let me go and find that needle. Maybe my remote control fell there one time and I've never looked for it. So now I'm going to find that. It's not a mitzvah to find a needle. And so you may get injured because your intention is also to do something that is not a mitzvah. So now a very interesting tangent, right? What is the status of a person who does something for two reasons at the same time? One is a good reason and one is a mundane reason. Okay, hi, Gavna. Lav misvahu. So we wonder, wait, if I do something for both reasons, are you telling me that nullifies? It's not a good, not considered misvah anymore? Atanya. Ha'omer se'la zo listaka b'shvir she'ichye b'ni. Oh, she'ye ben ha'olam haba. Someone says, I'm going to give this coin to tzedakah so that my son will get better, or so that I will get merit for the world to come. So he's giving tzedakah. It's true that is a mitzvah, but he's doing it for an ulterior motive. He's doing it for his own personal benefit. So is that really considered a mitzvah? Well, the statement Baraita says, "Hareh zeh tzadik gamur." This is a full-fledged, totally righteous person. So what do you see from here? That if someone has dual motivation, even if they're doing something for selfish interest, if it's also a mitzvah, we consider it a mitzvah. And therefore here also, when a person puts his hand in to look for the needle and also for the chametz, doesn't matter that he has an ulterior motive for to find the needle, since he's doing a mitzvah also, we consider it a mitzvah. So the answer is, Dilma batar debadak atela ayune batra. Now maybe it wasn't at the same time. Maybe he put his hand in, he found the chametz. And then he said, oh, while I'm here, let me look for my remote control. So you already performed the mitzvah, that's done. And now you're going to go and look for other things that might have fallen in there, and that is not a mitzvah, and you will come to harm. And that's why we have to make sure that a person does not does not look for chametz at all. Don't do bedikah for that reason. Okay, this is very, very interesting principle. Yeah?
Seems like a superstition.
The superstition is coming up.
No harm will come.
Well, no, it's actually being very safe. You know, don't put yourself in dangerous situations, right?
My brother was doing. I went to say Kaddish for my mother, and it was January, February, and he fell and broke his hip and needed surgery and went to the hospital. There was definitely right. No. I mean, so.
Right. Okay. Well, there's another limitation soon. That's a good point. So this is not something that you want to rely on a regular basis, for sure.
Right.
Okay. Good. A side point here is Tosafot asks a question. We just said that someone who gives tzedakah for ulterior motives is called tzaddik gamur. But this seems to contradict the Mishnah in Pirkei Avot that says, you should not be like a servant that serves his master in order to receive reward. Right? Rather, we should do mitzvot for their own sake. And reward comes, that's a side point, but we like doing it for its own sake. You know, if you ask your son, hey, can you please get me a cup of water? And he says, what are you going to give me if I get it for you? Right? What kind of thing is that? We do it for its own sake. So that should be considered not tzaddik gamur if he only does something for an ulterior motive. That's Tosafot's question. And they have a very nice answer. They say that, ask the person, let's say I say I'm going to give $100 so that this person will get better who's sick. And let's say they don't get better, right? And it doesn't work. Now, do I feel bad that I gave the money in the first place? Am I going to call the charity and say, I want my money back? It didn't work. Right, the person didn't get it for. So nobody does that. Obviously, people are. You've seen people do that, Dave? No, you're nodding like I know someone that did that. Nobody does that, right? Rather, you give charity. You know, you want to support the cause. While you're doing that, you say, "I hope this will be in the merit of a person that they should also get better." But that's not really your primary motivation. So therefore, that's why this Abraita is talking about. Still, Sadiq Amur, you're still doing good deed, and hopefully that's what you have in mind as well. Okay, it's like when Larry David donates the hospital wing, right? And he puts his name on it, and his friend puts anonymous, but tells everybody he's anonymous. He says, I don't know, you could be anonymous and tell everybody. So then he changed it to anonymous, and he tells everyone. All right, it's okay if your intention is to support the cause. And you also have your name on it. Maybe it'll encourage other people also to give more, right? So multiple motivations are still considered okay, as long as your main motivation is for the mitzvah. Okay, good. So that was one answer. And now a second answer. Why? What is called the sakana? We said don't put your hand into the wall because of danger. What's the danger? Rav Nachman bar Yitzchak Amar. Mishum sakanat goyim. Uflimuhi detanya. Chol sheben Yehudi la'aramai. Bodek ad mekom sheyado magat. Vashar mebatelo belibo. Pelimo amar. Kol atzmo eno bodek mepenei ha'sakana. So we're talking about danger from non-Jews. And it's the opinion of Pelimo. Plimo's interesting character on his own. There's some beautiful agada about him. But for a different time. So the Braita says that if you have a hole that's between in your wall, between where you live, your room, and a non-Jew, an Aramean, lives next door, and the hole goes all the way through. So the first opinion says I can check to where as far as my hand arm reaches, and the rest I don't have to care about. They say it's allowed. Plimo, however, says, do not do that. Do not check at all because of danger. What danger? My sakana. Inema sakanat keshafim. Kishtamesh hechi ishtamesh. So what kind of danger? Perhaps it's danger of witchcraft. In other words, when I put my hand in, especially with my lamp, the guy on the other side is going to see me doing something in the hole, and he's going to be suspicious. Says, what's this Jew doing, putting his hand in and with a flame in the hole and into my room? Maybe he's trying to curse me. He's trying to cast some kind of spell on me. And if the non-Jew suspects the Jew of casting on a spell upon him, then the non-Jew will retaliate and come and cause violence to the Jew. That's the danger that we're talking about. Okay. So if that's the case, then hold on. How did he use the pole in the first place? When he went and put chametz in there, then we have the same problem of danger that the non-Jew is going to see. Oh, he's putting something in the hole. He's trying to curse me. So a person wouldn't put the chametz there in the first place. So why would I think, why would I need to check it? When I put the chametz there, it was during the day and it was light, and so people don't do witchcraft during the day, so the non-Jew wouldn't have a problem with that. But here, at night, I'm using a candle, and I'm not sure exactly how this witchcraft works, but there's rules about it. And so that's the case where the non-Jew would suspect that the Jew was making a curse, and then he would retaliate. And so therefore, if you share, therefore the Beraita says, you don't have to check this hole in the wall. It's talking about this case where you share the wall with a non-Jew and you have to be afraid of this, of retaliation. We ask the same question. I thought you said, if I'm doing mitzvah, I'm doing bedechat chametz, so I don't have to worry about the non-Jew, what he thinks and what he might retaliate. So there's a very, very important limitation on this principle. Anytime that danger is likely to happen, if it's a commonplace thing, and that's different, you do not apply the principle in that case. So, for example, if there's a worldwide pandemic, then you do not say, oh, well, we can still come to Bet Knesset and pack everybody in without masks because we're doing a mitzvah, right? If the danger is likely to happen, if it's all over the place, then this principle does not apply. And therefore, we should make sure, even while we're doing a mitzvah, on the way to do mitzvah, to take all precautions and keep ourselves and everybody around us safe. So we learn this, where do we learn this from? An amazing story regarding Shemuel. Hashem comes and tells Shemuel, go and anoint David to be the next king. Shemuel tells God, wait, how can I go? Shaul, the current king, is going to hear about it. He's going to say, hey, Shemuel, where are you going? He's going to say, I'm going to appoint David as the next king. He says, what? He's going to get angry, and he'll harm Shemuel. Maybe he'll kill him, right? So how can I go? So Hashem's advice is, use an excuse. Take a calf with you, and then if anybody asks you, you say, oh, I'm taking this calf to Bethlehem. I'm going to make a sacrifice there. I'm going to invite some people. We're going to make a nice ceremony. So he's not lying because he'll do that also, but he has to hide the fact that he's actually going to anoint David. It's an amazing thing because even Hashem says, don't worry, I'll protect you. So here, Shemuel is going to do a mitzvah, but yet he doesn't say, oh, I'm doing the mitzvah, I'll be protected, there's no problem. No, even when you're going to do mitzvah, you still take all the precautions that you would normally take when you're traveling from some place. Okay, so I think now we have these two limitations, and we can put this principle into perspective. The point is, you know, it's encouraging people to go and do a mitzvah, but obviously safety comes first. Okay, good.
Rabbi.
Yep.
Do we know, is there a reason why they specified an Aramean? Is it just like...
No, I think that's just their way of saying...
Non-Jew?
Anybody.
Okay.
Why Hakam? Sometimes they say Nochri and sometimes Goy and sometimes
just here terms. it's a specific nationality, that's why.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know why specifically an Aramean here. You mean because of the magic? Maybe certain people that believe in certain kinds of magic? Maybe.
I don't know if it had anything, because it sounds a little bit like Ramai, like a trickster. I don't know.
Uh-huh. Okay, cool. All right. Good question. The sages asked the question of Rav. Hane bene be Rav, the daire be baga. Maulemete kadma behashucha le be Rav. So now that we're thinking about this principle that you don't have to worry about danger when you're going away to do a mitzvah, what do you do with these students who live out in the field? And they come during the day to study in the city. They do a reverse commute. Most people, they live in the city and they go out to the field to work. And so they, since they live in the field and they want to wake up early before dawn to come to the Beit Midrash, and they want to learn till late into the night, and they were going to return home while it's night out. Now, traveling outside the city at night is very dangerous. There's robbers, there's animals. And so the question came to Rav, what do you think? Can we travel at night to and from the Beit Midrash? Amar lehu netu alai ve'al savari. He says, coming to the Beit Midrash, you can rely on me. Don't worry, you come to the Beit Midrash early, even before dawn, and I will take responsibility for your safety. In other words, you're coming, you're on the way to come to the Beit Midrash, everything's good. Nezelmai, but how about going back home? When you're going back home, then you're leaving the Beit Midrash. Now you're not on the way to do a mitzvah. So as the protection still work? Amar lehu layadana, Rav didn't know the answer. Okay. Itemar, Amar Rabbi Elazar, Shiluchem mitzvah, and anizokin, lo balichatan, lo bahaziratan. Hold on, we can have an answer from the full statement of Rabbi Elazar that says, those who go to do a mitzvah are not harmed on the way there and on the way back. Because if they might be harmed on the way back, they're not going to want to go in the first place. This is like Hatzalah drivers. If you say, okay, you can go and save someone on Shabbat, but then you can't go back home. You have to stay in the hospital. They're not going to want to go in the first place. So therefore we say they can come back home. So here you go. See, he said on the way back too. So there, that would solve the problem of Rav, and that they could go back home even if it's late. Keman, Yihaitana, Detanya. Isi ben Yehuda omer kelape she'amra Torah ve'lo yachmod ish et arsecha melamed she'tehe paratcha ro'a ba'afar ben haya mezikata tanegolatcha menakeret be'ashpa ben choloda mezikata. Okay, so this opinion here to be Elazar says, even on the way home, you'll be safe. This is following the following Beraita. The Beraita is talking about when people would go on pilgrimage. They would all go to Jerusalem. So what's going to happen? All the men and the women, children, they all pack up and they go to Jerusalem. And who's left behind? Maybe infirm people, old people, they can't make the trip. So now what's going to happen if you leave the cities all devoid of most of the people? Well, animals are going to come, enemies are going to come, and they're going to take everything in the city. So this could be very dangerous. And therefore the Torah and Sefer Shemot says, Lo yachmod, don't worry. You can come to the Beit HaMikdash and come on the holiday, and your land will be safe. No one will yachmod. No one will covet your land when you go. Now, from the extra word lo yachmod ish et arsecha, that extra word et, we learn that even your cows that will go and graze in the meadow, the wild animals will not come and bother them, and your roosters that are going around and eating whatever is in the garbage, chulda. Choda is translated, could be a marten or a certain type of rat or a weasel, one of these kinds of rodents will not come and harm the rooster. So you're safe from physical, from human enemies, and also safe from animal enemies. Okay. Now, if animals where they don't get their own protection, I mean, animals are just domesticated animals are open to harm, and they will not be harmed. So, people who can protect themselves, people who have providence on their side, all the more so, they will not be harmed. When? On the way there, on the way back? Enli ela balicha, I only know on the way there. Hazra minayin, how about after the holiday is over, and now you're on your way back home? Maybe now you're not going to do a mitzvah, now you're just returning home. Is the protection force field still in force? Tamod lomar, ufanita baboker, valachta leohalecha, melamed shetelech betimsa aholcha b'shalom. A different pasuk in Devarim says that after you do Korban Pesach, then you go back to your ohel. Everybody goes back. So saying that, is teaching that you should go back the ohalecha, and everything will be safe when you go. So therefore, you see from this extended baraita that not only on the way to a mitzvah, but also on the way home, there is protection. Okay, good. Now we have a question. Since the second pasuk teaches me that on the way home I'm protected, why do I even need the first pasuk to tell me that on the way there I'm protected? If on the way home I'm protected, all the more so on the way there. Lecha d'Rabbi Ami, d'Amar Rabbi Ami, kol adam sheyesh lo karka ole la regel, v'she'en lo karka en ole la regel. Teaches a different law that the only people who are required to have a mitzvah, they have to go on pilgrimage, are the landowners. They have land, they come, they bring their bikurim, they have to come to Jerusalem. But if the person is not a landowner, then they are not obligated to come. And that's what the first mitzvah is saying. Your land will be protected. The point is you own land, and that's why you would need to come. All right, so that ends that fascinating and important discussion. And now, something else about those who make a pilgrimage. Amarabi Abin bar Rav Ada Amarabi Yitzchak. Mipenema en perot ginosar birushalayim. Kedeh shelo yihu oleh regalim omrim. Ilmale lo alinu, ela lechol perot ginosar birushalayim. Dayenu, imset aliyah shelo lishma. And this relates not only to pilgrimage, but also doing things for ulterior motives. So the question is, this Perot Ginosar. Ginosar is a town up in the Galilee. You can go there today. There's a kibbutz around Ginosar. And it's well known. And nowadays, it only gets tourism. But back then, it was known for the amazing fruits that grew there that were bigger and sweeter than all other fruits. And the question is, if these beautiful fruits, why isn't Jerusalem blessed with to have them? Why are they up in the Galilee? And the answer is, so that those who come on the pilgrimage to come for the Hag, they won't say, they'll come for the fruit and they'll eat the fruit and say, oh, if we came to Jerusalem just for the fruit, Dayenu, that would be enough. And so they would come for ulterior motives and not come because of the mitzvah itself. And therefore, those fruits do not grow in Jerusalem. This is very applicable today because sometimes today people come to Jerusalem for Pesach, for Sukkot. They stay in the King David Hotel and they get the amazing breakfast and the cheese and the dates and the yogurts and the warm chocolate cake. I don't know who eats warm chocolate cake for breakfast. I still haven't figured that one out, right? But maybe they'll say, oh, see, it's a good thing we came to Jerusalem so that we can get the King David breakfast. But then they're coming for ulterior motives. So therefore, you should make sure, you know, not to come only for that reason. You should make sure to come for the mitzvah itself. And then also while you're there, you can appreciate the beautiful land of milk and honey and wonderful fruits that are there as well. Okay, good. Kayosebo amarabi dostai berabi yanai, mipnema en hamete beria birushalayim, kedeshelo yu ole regalim omrim el male lo alinu el alirhos, be hamete beria, beyenu, nimset aliyah, shelo lishma. Similarly, these hot springs of Tiberias, these natural hot springs, I'm sure a lot of people have been there. Why aren't they in Jerusalem? So that the people that come to Jerusalem can enjoy them. The same reason that they shouldn't come and say, oh, this is a good thing we came to Jerusalem just for these hot springs. And then they'll be doing it not for the mitzvah, but for ulterior motives. And therefore, they are located in Tiberias and not in Jerusalem. All right, we finished with that beautiful Agadah. Now we're just gonna end with the next section of the Mishnah. We can complete this Mishnah. Okay, the Mishnah, if you remember, said that any place that you do not bring chametz, you don't have to do bedika. And then they say, "Velama amru." Why did they say two rows in the wine cellar, a place where you do bring chametz? And then they talk about what is the wine cellar. What are the two rows? And so the question is here: who mentioned anything about a wine cellar that they're asking? And what about the two rows of the wine cellar? Generally, a wine cellar, you would assume you don't have to do bidika because you don't bring chametz there. So why is the Mishnah now all of a sudden assuming, right? We saw in the introduction that this Lama Amru is quoting an ancient Torah Shebaal Peh. And they say, why they say that? Because it's contradictory to the basic principle. Any place that you don't bring chametz, you don't have to check. So then, why did they say this law about the martef? Okay, so that's what the Gemara is going to explain now. And I don't bring chametz there, I don't do bedika. And the basic law is a storage place of wine or oil. You don't have to check. And that which they did teach, that when in some cases you have to check the two rows in the cellar, that's talking about where I access it during the meal. And therefore, the person that goes and gets it might bring chametz and forget it there. And that's the case I have to check. Good. Bet Shammai omrim shete shurot. So Bet Shammai says two rows is exact words. Two rows upon the entire wine cellar. And Bet Hillel says shte shurot hachitzonot shena elyonot. Only the two rows that are outer and upper. Oh, so let's try to figure out what they mean by that. There's a machloket. Amar Rabbi Yehuda shete shurot shamru min ha'aretz v'ad sheme koral. Rabbi Yochanan amar shura achat kemin gam. The first opinion of Yehuda says two rows means, picture is worth a thousand words here. Two rows means this entire front and the one behind it, right? So two entire rows going in. According to Rabbi Yochanan, two rows means one in front and one on top. This picture has a mistake in it. Should not be the second one here, but rather one vertical and one horizontal. Those are the two opinions. We saw that Aror Tosefta has this interpretation, one horizontal and one vertical. And Gemara continues, actually quoting a Tosefta, but also another Braita. Tanya kevated Rabbi Yehuda, Tanya kevated Rabbi Yochanan. These two Amoraim each have a Braita from the Tanaim that supports their opinion. Let's read them. Tanya kevated Rabbi Yehuda, Bet Shammai omrim shete shurot al pene kol amartef, ushte shurot shamru min ha'aretz v'ad sheme kora. So it's two rows from the floor up to the ceiling, two rows deep. That's Rabbi Yehuda. Tanya kevated Rabbi Yochanan, shete shurot al pene kol amartef, so only the front one and the top one, but not the one that's behind them or under them. Okay, good. So that was Bet Shammai. We're going to end with Bet Hillel. Bet Hillel omrim shete shurot hachitzonot shena alyonot. He says only the front ones that are on top. Amar Rav. Rav says, talking about the top one and the one right under it. Means the top one and the one right behind it. Here's the picture. This is Rav, right? The top front one and the one right under. And Shmuel says, the top one and the one inside behind it. That second one there. Okay. And they also have, but I thought, first, why? My Tama. Why does Rav say the front ones? Because it says the ones in the front, chitzonot, outside. But also says above. So I wouldn't think that's talking about the ones all the way on the bottom. So it's the two rows, the top one and the one under it, but it's the upper ones. Ushmela Mar Eliona Shivnim Hemena. My Tama Dayek Elionot. Why does Yumel say the top one, the one behind it? It says top, so it has to be all the way on top. Or what about Chitzona? Also says front. So what does that mean? The Muteg Givaita de Givaita. That's to exclude the ones all the way in the back. So that's what I have to tell you, not the ones all the way in the back, but the first, the top two rows, the front one and the one going in. Okay. Rabbi Chiya Tane Kevate de Rav. Bechulehu Tane Tanu Kevate de Shmuel. So regarding the Baraitot, Rabbi Chiya is the only one that has a Baraita that supports it. All the other Tanaim, all the other memorizers, these professional memorizers, and remembered all the Baraitot, they all said like Shmuel. Hilchetan Nahalacha follows Kevate de Shmuel, should follow Shmuel. That's the end of the daf. Oh, one more point is that Rambam says Pesach Halacha like Rav in this case, which is kind of surprising because the final word is Hilchata Kevate de Shmuel, which shows that most likely Rambam did not have these last three words in his version of the Talmud. And often what happens is the Hilchata at the end of a sugya is actually something that is added on later in times of Geonim, or even later by others who just want to put a gloss into the manuscript. This is, by the way, this is the halacha, but they are not authoritative because they're not from the time of the Amoraim themselves. And that's why, since Rambam probably didn't have those words, he actually says, Pesach Halacha is like Rav. Baruch Adonai L'olam, Amen ve'amen.